Now I would like to hand over the call to you. Now you can take over. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
हरे कृष्णा। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंदा जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौर भक्तवृंदा जय जय श्री चैतन्य जय नित्यानंदा जय द्वैत चंद्र जय गौर भक्तवृंदा। सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम चैतन्य चरितामृता मध्य लीला चैप्टर 18 टेक्स्ट नंबर 118। आकृत्ये तो मारे ढेकी व्रजेन्द्र नंदना देह कांति पीतांबर कैल आचाढ़ना। बाय योर बॉडीली फीचर्स वी कैन सी दैट यू आर नन अदर देन the son of Nanda Maharaj, although the golden luster of your body has covered your original complexion. Text number 119. Mriga Mada Vastre Bhande Tabuna Lukaya Ishvara Swabhava Tomara Dhaka Nahiyaya. As the aroma of deer musk cannot be concealed by wrapping it in a cloth, your characteristics as the Supreme Personality of Godhead cannot be concealed by any means. Text number 120. Alaukika Prakriti Tomar Buddhi Agochara Tomadeki Krishna Preme Jagat Pagala. Indeed, your characteristics are uncommon and beyond the imagination of an ordinary living being. Simply by seeing you, the entire universe becomes mad with ecstatic love for Krishna. Text 121. Tribala Vriddha Arachandala Yavana Paya Dharshana Krishna Namalayanache Hana Unmata Acharya Haila Sei Tarila Jagata. If they see you just once, even women, children, old men, meat eaters, and members of the lowest caste immediately chant the holy name of Krishna and dance like madmen and become spiritual masters capable of delivering the whole world. This is text number 121 and 122. So we are reading text 123. दर्शनेर कार्य आचूक एतोमार नाम सुने से कृष्ण प्रेमे मत तारे त्रिभुवने। अपार्ट फ्रॉम सीइंग यू हूएवर लिसन्स योर होली नेम इज मेड मैड विद एक्स्टैटिक लव फॉर कृष्णा एंड इज एबल टू डिलीवर द थ्री वर्ल्ड्स। टेक्स्ट नंबर 124. तोमार नाम सुनिहया स्वपक स्वपच पावना अलौकिक शक्ति तोमार नायाय कतना। सिंपली बाय हियरिंग योर होली नेम डॉग ईटर्स बिकम होली सेंट्स। योर अनकॉमन पोटेंसीज कैनॉट बी डिस्क्राइब्ड इन वर्ड्स। वी विल डिस्कस टिल 124। ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। नमः ओम विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामिन् इति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे।
So today we are discussing from Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila, chapter 18, text number 118 to 124. This chapter is on Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's visit to Sri Vrindavana. The text that we read today, they are coming in the context where Mahaprabhu is visiting various places in Vrindavan, and as he was visiting these places, he is interacting with devotees. And this particular verse, or the set of verses, are spoken by the people who were hearing from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. A small background is that when Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in Vrindavan, Balabhadra Bhattacharya happened to go and see a boatman, and in the night, where all the Vrindavan devotees, all people started to misunderstand the boatman as Krishna, and Krishna has reappeared. And Balabhadra Bhattacharya got a tight slap from Chaitanya Mahaprabhu for his speculation. And after that, Mahaprabhu had expressed his anguish, saying that how come we misunderstand, how come we get carried away by the opinion of speculators. And we had a discussion on how speculation in our devotional life is detrimental. So this particular verse is after that, when Mahaprabhu, when all the devotees, all the people said, Mahaprabhu, that you are Krishna yourself. And Mahaprabhu said that, no, no, I am not Krishna. I am a devotee of the Supreme Lord. And when Mahaprabhu denied, so then the people assembled over there, they are describing about Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's glories. So, in our discussion today, we will understand some aspects of devotional life. In our last class, I think 15 days before, we discussed the principle on LEARN, an acronym. We learned a principle of LEARN, how spiritual knowledge can never be taught, it has to be learned. How devotional service can never be taken, we have to be empowered. And how when we learn by surrendering to a bona fide spiritual master, doing menial service and asking relevant questions submissively, we get to learn the spiritual knowledge. And with the learning and empowerment from the spiritual master, our anarthas in the heart starts to go away. And when anartha go away, we are revealed. Krishna revealed himself, and eventually our devotional gets fixed. So we saw L-E-A-R-N, learning, empowerment, anartha, nirvritti. Krishna reveals himself, and nishtha. We discussed this in our last session. So we will continue from there on how, when these devotees or when the people assembled over there, they said one thing from verse number 118 onwards. Every verse they are explaining about Mahaprabhu's special qualities and how they recognize how somebody can somebody, when they get the darshan of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, their life gets transformed. This can be a set of checklists from our side, where we can understand that these are all things that are pretty commonly going to happen when somebody is going to be in the contact, be in the association of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. In text number 118, it is said that your bodily features, you can see that you are none other than son of Nanda Maharaj, although the golden lustre of your body has covered your original complexion. So the devotees assembled over there, they are clarifying to Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that he is Krishna himself from various realizations. So our first reflection in our this 5-6 verses is that this Krishna consciousness process is so sublime, is so powerful, that even an ordinary person, even a person who does not have any devotional sentiments, who does not have any devotional experiences, a person who does not have anything to do with devotional life, can start to experience the highest form of devotional life. That's because the source that is, the source from which we receive them is very, very powerful. So Srila Prabhupada in his cassette, in his recording to the Hare Krishna Dhun, he said, a child can take part in the chanting, even a dog can take part in the chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So in our journey of Krishna consciousness, we need to understand that it is not by our ability that we are progressing in Krishna consciousness. It is not by our endeavor we are moving forward in Krishna consciousness. It is not anything by ourselves things are happening. It is the process, and the people involved in the process are very, very powerful and very, very special, that because of them we progress in our devotional life. So we discuss that how till Nishtha state we discussed, L-E-A-R-N. So we will now discuss from Nishtha to Prema. So from Nishtha to Prema, Rupa Goswami explains a very interesting point, that Nectar of Devotion says our action in Krishna consciousness is evolving from Shraddha, Sadhu Sangha, Bhajana Kriya, Anartha Nivritti, and etc. till Prema. And this pure devotion service gives rise to 6 characteristics feature. It's a very interesting, it's in the first chapter of NOD, Prabhupada writes. The 6 characteristics features, it's very nicely organized. And the first and foremost of all the 6 is Kleshagni. Kleshagni means the pure devotion service is potent enough to clean, to uproot all the unwanted things in the heart that got accumulated since time immemorial. So it's Kleshagni, is completely removing all the unwanted things in the heart. This is the power of pure devotion service. When giving an explanation to this, Srila Prabhupada explains, and there are other explanations with Acharyas. So out of the 6 characteristic features, first 2 of them, they manifest in sadhana bhakti. The second 2 in the characteristic features, they manifest when we rise up from sadhana bhakti to bhava bhakti. And the last 2 of the characteristics of pure devotion service, they manifest when we practice prema bhakti. So I will read the 6 characteristics features defined by Srivad Rupa Goswami. Number 1, pure devotion service brings immediate relief from all kinds of material distress. 2, pure devotion service is the beginning of all auspiciousness. 3, pure devotion service automatically puts one in transcendental pleasure. 4, pure devotion service is rarely achieved. 5, those in pure devotion service derive even the conception of liberation. And 6, pure devotional service is the only means to attract Krishna. So the interesting explanation that is given by Acharyas are this, of these six characteristics of pure devotional service. First two, Kleshagni is the first one, which means brings immediate relief from all kinds of material distress. And number two is Shubhada. Shubhada means pure devotional service is the beginning of all auspiciousness. So, and the remaining, the third and fourth manifest when we move from the stage of Sadhana Bhakti to Bhava Bhakti, and the remaining two manifest from the stage when we move from Bhava Bhakti to Prema. So these 6-7 verses that the devotees shared as their experience, we can see that they can come from different quarters or different set of realizations. Some of them could be in Sadhana Bhakti, some of them could be in Bhava Bhakti, some of them could be in Prema Bhakti, some of them are just onlookers. So our first realization or first reflection today is that this pure devotional service is something very, very sublime, that whoever comes in contact with that, Prabhupada writes in one of the purports, how a bell metal, when it comes in contact with a specific set of chemicals, will become gold. Similarly, we are all, without this Krishna consciousness process, we all don't have any qualification. There is no adhikar. There is no rights for us to even sit and touch and talk about the subject matter of the Supreme Lord. But this subject matter is so sublime that when we come in contact with them, we get transformed. Srila Prabhupada explains in the preface of Nectar of Devotion, he writes a very interesting point that we are trying to keep our body fit by all means, but we are neglecting to supply foodstuffs to the stomach. Missing Krishna means missing one's self also. Real self-realization and realization of Krishna go together simultaneously. For example, seeing oneself in the morning means seeing the sunrise also. Without seeing the sunshine, no one can see himself. Similarly, unless one has realized Krishna, there is no question of self-realization. This is the first and very interesting point to understand. Many times we have some cognizance, some knowledge, some intelligence, and trying to realize about ourselves and think around us. But Prabhupada gave a very fantastic example here, that if I am able to see my hand, if I am able to see my body, if I am able to see something, we immediately start to think, it is my ability to see. Because I have eyes, because I have life, because I have intelligence, I can see, I can infer, I can interpret. But Srila Prabhupada says, you can never understand who you are independent of understanding who Krishna is. And Prabhupada's example is that how I am seeing this object, I am seeing myself, I am seeing various things, not by the ability of my eyes. It is because of the presence of sunlight or because of the presence of any other artificial light. Who saw this sunlight? So Krishna Surya Saman Maya Hara Antaha. So Krishna is like the source and we are all just part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. So we need to realize that our progress in Krishna consciousness, our appreciation of Krishna consciousness, our journey in Krishna consciousness is very much integrated and is very much intertwined in our understanding, our realizing the Supreme Lord. And we don't need to have a very high fund of knowledge. We don't need to be an expert. We don't need to be a scholar. We just need to stay where we are because we have already been blessed to be part of this movement. How did we come in this movement? What brought us to this movement is a history. In spite of us, in spite of our past, in spite of where we come from, we have somehow got into this process of Krishna consciousness. Now we need to latch onto this. So our first reflection is that these people said, Mahaprabhu, you are not an ordinary person. Like how they gave an example of a deer's skin, the aroma can be, you know, not hidden, how much ever you try to manage it. Similarly, oh my dear Lord Gauranga, you are Krishna himself, you can't hide yourself from us. So with that set of realization, we get to understand that our spiritual life today, what we have received is a special blessing, and it is not so easily available to others. Hence, let's start to recognize and take advantage of this wonderful process of Krishna consciousness. So our first reflection is that Krishna consciousness process that we have received is so sublime that even a person who does not have any prayer qualification can start to appreciate the Supreme Lord. Like even when somebody may have a lot of any other things, just because of the sunlight, by the power of sunlight, they are able to see the object. So it is by the mercy of the Lord we are able to perform what we are able to perform, and hence we need to be grateful for this process. The second reflection that I would like to share is that the people of Vrindavan, they mentioned in verse number 120, indeed your characteristics are uncommon and beyond the imagination of an ordinary living being. Simply by seeing you, the entire universe becomes mad with the ecstatic love for Krishna. So it was very nicely explained by somebody that for us to appreciate something is good, for us to appreciate something is great, for us to appreciate something is transcendental, we need not be in transcendental mode. Even we are in a conditioned state, we can very easily appreciate by the context, by the situation, and by various other external arrangement, you will be able to appreciate that this is transcendental. So these people are appreciating Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and say that as soon as somebody see you, my dear Lord, they go mad. And this was the case in Jagannath Puri, this was the case when Krishna was on this planet, and this was the case when Mahaprabhu went to different places. So our second reflection is that when we are it's very natural to understand that when we come in contact with the Supreme Lord, we should also develop some amount of madness. Ishwarapuri, he said to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that you go on chanting Hare Krishna Mahamantra, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. You go on chanting, and that's the Adesh, that's the instruction that I give you. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked him, my dear Guru Maharaj, how long I should be doing this? Ishwarapuri responded, saying that you go on doing this till you become mad after the holy name. So the devotees or the people who are gathered around Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they are mentioning, my dear Mahaprabhu, your Krishna himself, just by seeing you, people go mad. So when we are regularly taking darshan of the Supreme Lord, when we are regularly coming in contact with the holy name, when we are regularly coming into contact with the deity, when we are regularly coming in contact with Krishna's pastimes, why are we not having that experience? Is it because of something shortage from Krishna, or why? So that brings in our second reflection. So here it is said that anybody who comes in contact with the Supreme Lord, they get mad. Krishna is in the form of Harsha Vigraha. How much we get ecstatic when we see him. Krishna is in the form of holy name. How much ecstatic we get to get when we have the chanting of the holy name of the Lord. So a very interesting example is given for this. The example is that for us to get mad, for us to get ecstatic, for us to get highly devotionally, sentimentally, and we get to be in that state, what stops us? Even though we are chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, we are in contact, in the touch with so many wonderful Krishna consciousness process. Is there a shortcoming from Krishna's side? No. So Krishna is giving his mercy to everybody unconditionally. Krishna is not doing any partiality. Krishna's mercy is flowing. When a same person is giving mercy to everybody equally, but different people are receiving them differently. So there is no problem with respect to transmission of Krishna's mercy. There is no problem with respect to what Krishna is doing upon us. It is upon us, there is something that we need to do. An example is given, is that when a TV channel, when they are transmitting a signal, say for example, Star TV, BBC, ESPN, whatever the channel that you may know, the transmission side is seamlessly transmitting the content. For us to see the content, for us to receive the content, for us to appreciate the content, we need to have an instrument, and that is not sufficient. We need to have the instrument tuned to the frequency, and we need to also need to have electricity connection to make the instrument function. So these three components are required for us to actually receive the content seamlessly. Number one, we need to have a proper set of instruments. We need to have a frequency tuned to that instrument. And more so, we need to have electricity connection at home or the place to power up the devices. So when we are not getting ecstasy, when we are not getting the transcendental emotions, when we come in contact with the Supreme Lord or the Holy Name or His devotees, it is not the problem of transmission. It is a problem of, you need to check which one of these three are missing. And what are these three in our life? The machine or the TV or the mobile signal or whatever that instrument is our this human body. This human form of life is very special, unique, important, because this is a device. This is a device which is used to process what is being provided. In no other form of life we can appreciate, we can glorify the Supreme Lord. So first is this human form of life, that's a machine. What is the frequency? The frequency is that you tune your consciousness, we tune our attitude, we tune our mentality in line with what Krishna is expecting us. So we need to tune the frequency of our consciousness in such a way that it resonates with the frequency that Krishna expects us for receiving the particular content. Just having an instrument does not suffice anything. Just having a human form of life does not suffice anything. Srimad Bhagavatam very strongly condemns those eyes which does not see the Supreme Lord, those head which does not bow down to the Supreme Lord, those legs which does not go to the Supreme Lord, and those person who does not go to the Supreme Lord, Bhagavatam explains, those eyes which does not see the Supreme Lord is just like the eye in the peacock feather. Using the eyes in the peacock feather, you can't see an object. It is just looking like a beautiful eye-shaped, part in the peacock feather. And the leg which does not visit the Supreme Lord temple, it is like a tree trunk. So Bhagavatam explains how by having all these things, like how Srila Prabhupada wrote here, just by having eyes and ability to see does not entitle us to see. Only because sunlight is there we could see. So the point is, the machine which helps us to tune our frequency with the Lord is a human form, and the frequency is our attitude. Srila Prabhupada writes in the preface of Nectar of Instruction, the Krishna, the attitude, the purpose of this Krishna consciousness movement is to change the attitude of his followers. I'm paraphrasing this. So Srila Prabhupada is insisting on our attitude. If our attitude is not changed, if our propensity is not changed, if our mentality is not changed, how much ever externally we may be qualified, how much ever externally we may be well equipped, we will, our frequency won't be, you know, matching. That's what Srila Prabhupada wrote here. That we may try to keep our body fit. We may try to do all the necessary things to keep us, you know, healthy and wealthy. But that doesn't solve us our purpose. So the second thing is attitude. And what is the third thing in terms of electricity? The electricity which keeps us alive, which keeps the whole function of the, you know, system, including the machine, and helps the frequency to work. That's the sutra behind this. So that which helps, that which underlies, which is the reason for us to get connected, is our connection with our spiritual master. So if our connection with our spiritual master is disconnected, you can't definitely develop a attitude, and hence this human form of life is waste. So this connection with the spiritual master, connection with the guru, happens to be a fundamental foundation to strike a chord with the Supreme Lord. So if ever we don't are not able to experience the madness that we are supposed to have experienced, so we need to see how much we are resonating to the mood that spiritual master is empowering us. Srila Prabhupada had been very, very vocal about this, that without the mercy of spiritual master, a disciple can't make a progress. And it is the duty of the disciple to understand, appreciate, and apply what the spiritual master is instructing and walk in the path to see Krishna face to face. There are many, many purports Prabhupada, you know, paraphrases this. So our second reflection is that today we are not able to see Krishna, and today we are not able to be mad when we see Krishna. Today we are not able to recognize behind Krishna, Krishna behind every activity, is because either the instrument is not proper, which means we are not maintaining the human form of life, we are not keeping the body fit. Second is our attitude is not rightly tuned, and we are not walking as suggested, as instructed by our spiritual authorities. So the second reflection helps us in going back to the foundations of our spiritual life, in which we need to take care of our body, we need to take care of our consciousness, and we need to take care of our association. It's a very simple but very important point. So when the people are saying that ordinary people can't understand this, he says that it's beyond the imagination of ordinary living beings. And he says that if somebody gets mad after them, then they are very, very, you know, blessed. Then the people are going ahead and saying, the next point, it says, if they see you just once, even women, children, old men, meat eaters, and members of the lower caste immediately chant the holy name of Krishna, dance like madmen, and become spiritual master capable of delivering the whole world. So, this is another very wonderful glorification, and this brings in our third reflection. This is our ISKCON movement. This one particular, or this two verses, 121 and 122, is nothing but the result of this ISKCON movement. Srila Prabhupada, he was sitting in Thompson Fire Park, and all he had was a pair of karkal, and he kept on chanting Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And whoever heard them, and those who heard Srila Prabhupada, they were not some self-realized souls. Those who heard Srila Prabhupada, they were not some yogis or munis or rishis or somebody who is hankering for spiritual knowledge. All those who heard Srila Prabhupada were really hardcore self-gratifiers, deeply grounded in their own self-gratificatory lifestyle. So here it is explained that if even one.
If they see you just once, even women, old men, children, meat eaters, members of the lower caste, immediately chant the holy name of Krishna, dance like madmen, and become spiritual masters capable of delivering the whole world. Srila Prabhupada did this and demonstrated this, how this power of holy name is. I heard a lecture from Badri Narayan Maharaj recently. So he was mentioning in the class that one day they went for doing a Harinam Sankirtan, and it was a very cold evening, and when they went for doing Harinam Sankirtan, so nobody were there in the street, and there are many such stories I have heard, but this is the recent one that I heard. So when they were singing in the streets, and then one boy came, and he started to hear the kirtan, and immediately started to, the devotee started to pull him in the kirtan, and he reluctantly joined the kirtan and eventually started to dance and sing and stuff like that. And later when devotees inquired him, or he came to the devotees and shared and thanked them for saving him, he said that he was going to go to kill himself because he got so much dejected in his life, he didn't know what to do. So he was going to suicide himself by hanging himself from the top of the tree. He pointed out the tree. I was going to hang from that place, and I saw you guys doing kirtan. I saw you guys singing very happily and enthusiastically dancing. Then somehow I got attracted and I came, and when I started dancing and being with you guys, I felt better, and my mood to suicide is completely now changed. So there are many, many stories, and most of us are in this movement because of some way or the other, the holy name, the Krishna's darshan, Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's devotees, Krishna's dham, something of Krishna attracted us. We have not developed yet the higher superlative taste for it, but something have attracted us to this process. That is why we are, you know, this movement. And here it is explained, just by that one darshan, once, they will grow up to the stage of eventually becoming spiritual masters to deliver more and more people. How this statement is, sometimes it looks like an exaggeration, but this statement is like a capsule which has got many, many siddhanta built into this. Sadhu Sanghe, Sadhu Sanghe, Sarva Shastra Hoy, Lava Matra Sadhu Sanghe, Sarva Siddhi Hoy. So the point is that if somebody associates with their devotee for 1/11th of a second, 1/11th of a second is, you know, by the time you stated it, it's gone. Chaitanya says, we get delivered. So, the process is so sublime that it can eventually, you know, put us to the path of winning more souls to Krishna. So, here the devotees are glorifying Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If somebody gets your darshan even once, they are capable of becoming spiritual masters, and they become like a madman. As I said, this is the appropriate words to define ISKCON movement. How all those people, how if you are reading Leelamrita regularly, how Keith, when he first met Srila Prabhupada, how all the earlier days, how Kirtananda Maharaj, Umapati Maharaj, you know, so many early stalwarts, they naturally got attracted to Swamiji just because of the simple karsal that he played and, you know, small single kirtan that he sung. So it means we have a dormant Krishna consciousness within our heart, and this dormant Krishna consciousness is awakened when we come in contact with this wonderful Krishna consciousness process. But the point in this verse is, even if you have been a meat eater, even if you have been a drunkard, even if you have been a chandala, you are still forgiven, you are purified, and your state is superlatively positioned. So our third reflection is that what Kevalashtakam is saying.
ఆబ్రహ్మస్తంభ పర్యంతం సర్వం మాయామయం జగత్ సత్యం సత్యం పునః సత్యం హరేర్నామైవ కేవలం. ఆ బ్రహ్మస్తంభ పర్యంతం సర్వం మాయామయం జగత్ సత్యం సత్యం పునః సత్యం హరేర్నామైవ కేవలం. దిస్ హోలీ నేమ్ ఆఫ్ ద లార్డ్ హరే కృష్ణ హరే కృష్ణ 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 హరే 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 రామ హరే రామ 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 హరే హరే రైట్ ఫ్రమ్ బ్రహ్మ టిల్ ద లోవెస్ట్ స్పీషీస్. ఆ బ్రహ్మ స్తంభ పర్యంతం సర్వం మాయామయం జగత్ ఎవ్రీథింగ్ ఎల్స్ ఇస్ మాయా. వాట్ ఇస్ ద ఓన్లీ ట్రూత్? సత్యం సత్యం పునః సత్యం హరేర్ నామైవ కేవలం. సో హియర్ దే ఆర్ సేయింగ్ విత్ సో మచ్ కన్విక్షన్ that if somebody comes in contact with the holy name of the Lord, if somebody comes in contact with the Supreme Lord and taken darshan, it may so appear that we are not changed, but every darshan, every contact, every touch, every move towards the Supreme Lord, we are changing. Every day we are changing. All we need to do is don't come in the way of our progress. The process works. Just be part of the process, rest everything the process of Krishna consciousness will do it. In spite of us, we are making progress. Meaning, whether we are qualified or not qualified, this process is so powerful that it will transform us. I used to always give this example. In Mumbai, if we need to board a local train on a Monday morning office hour. If you have been to Mumbai, you know, please, you know, once see this from distant place. To board a Mumbai local train on a Monday morning 8:30, 9 o'clock, you need to have a knack. The train will stop for 10 seconds, thousands of people board in, thousands of people, you know, come out of the train. And what is the technique for that? The technique for that is, we sandwich ourselves. We position ourselves to come in front of the gate. Somebody will take you in, somebody will take you out. Similarly, in our Krishna consciousness process, the process works independent of who we are. The reason different categories are mentioned, because Bhagavad Gita says different categories of people. We can discuss separately why men, why Shudras, why all those things. There is a reason behind that. But we'll discuss it on a separate context. This Prabhupada explains it many places. In teachings of Queen Kunti explains, in Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter explains, and here also it is mentioned. But the point is, whoever a person may be, however lower consciousness a person could go, but if they got darshan of the Lord once, they will definitely one day make it to become spiritual masters. That's the power of the Lord's darshan. So the transmission is so powerful, even one darshan can change, but the receptionist needs to be very vigilant and active to reciprocate that. So when Krishna is giving his darshan, we should tune up our frequency in such a way that we receive them. So our third reflection is that this Krishna consciousness process, it's a promise. It's a confirmation, it's an experience that we will gain, that every time that we come in contact with the Supreme Lord, we move progressively. And what are those progressively that we can realize it now, is those two things that we just read. Number one, Kleshagni. Number two, Shubhada. The remaining four we may not be able to experience now, but first and two, we will start experiencing. We will start experiencing some Klesha. Some unwanted things in the heart will start to go away. I am sure from the day one of our Krishna consciousness, something kept on going away, something kept on going away, something kept on going away. One day one girl came to Srila Prabhupada and she said, Swamiji, Your chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra that you have recommended is so nice. It is very, very nice that when I chant, a red light I could see in front of my eyes. So she was so serious when she was explaining about this. So Srila Prabhupada replied that please keep chanting more, that will also go away. So we develop so many quotients as we come in Krishna consciousness. We may develop some superiority complex. We may develop some diplomacy complex. We may have so many complexes that we may build. But all those complexes will go away slowly, slowly. Every darshan, every time when we come in contact with the Supreme Lord. So our third reflection is that please come in contact with Lord Krishna. Then what happens? We will also become Krishna. Otherwise, we will be staying separate. For us, we will have no value. If the hair is connected to this body, the hair is beauty. Adding to this beauty, I mean, I'm not sure if it's beauty or not, but so long as this hair is connected to the body, it has some value. People comb their hair, people keep their hair clean, people try to, you know, decorate themselves. But if one hair is removed from the body, the same thing which is adding to the beauty of the body is now filthy. It's very important. So we need to hence be connected to the source, and we being connected to the source, day by day we make progress, and eventually we come to a state where we win more and more souls to Supreme Lord. That's the state Krishna takes us to. How fast we move is in our hands. But what gets manifested? These two things. Kleshagni, Subhada. Unwanted things starts to go away and auspiciousness starts to manifest. And what is auspiciousness? In sometimes it may be removal of wealth, sometimes it's additional of wealth. But auspiciousness means you get to see Krishna's hand behind every action. That's called auspiciousness. You will be able to see Krishna's hand behind everything that is going on. So that you will be able to see. That's our third realization today. The fourth realization, Rupa Goswami in his Upadesha, in his Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu says that when somebody comes to the stage of Nishta or, you know, Anartha Nivritti, when they are just outside of Anartha Nivritti and slowly coming to Nishta, so then there are five stages: Nishta, Ruchi, Ashakti, Bhava, Prema. These five stages are defined in five different ways. He says, it's very interesting, it's a bit technical. What Rupa Goswami explains is that when somebody is in the stage of Nishta, they are able to partially see Krishna behind everything. Or they are able to appreciate the Supreme Lord presence, Supreme Lord's Leela partially, not fully. At Nishta they can't see fully. When they develop further devotional sentiments and they develop devotional quotient, then partially becomes almost completely. So there are technical words that Rupa Goswami defines this, but I'm just trying to keep it simple for our discussion. So first we see partially, then we see almost completely, then we see completely, then we see thoroughly, then we see absolutely thoroughly. The reason I'm clarifying this is Krishna consciousness journey is very nice. Gauranga Prabhu used to always say the first three lectures in ISKCON is free and you will be treated royal. From the fourth lecture onwards, you are asked or you are inspired or you are enabled to do something. And we get so much captivated into this process that we also wish to do it, and eventually we get slowly, slowly deeper ourselves in this path of Krishna consciousness. And he used to give an example. When a boy joins an engineering college, he stays in the hostel. He doesn't have a habit of smoking, drinking or anything. The first day, the seniors come and say, "Hey, smoke a cigarette." This boy would say reluctantly, "No, no, I won't smoke cigarette." But they will force him to smoke. The second day, they will come and force him to smoke a cigarette. The third day, they may still do the same. And the fourth day, they won't come. This boy would go after them and say, "Hey, can I have a cigarette?" Because in these 3 days, he got addicted to this habit. So he used to explain how the first three lectures or first three associations are so interesting. We welcome you, we make you sit, we give you gift, we, you know, appreciate you, we say Haribol to you. You feel like you are treated like a royal king. Wow, somebody is treating me. Sometimes we get a garland. But from the fourth lecture onwards, "Prabhuji, can you please take care of the shoe stand? Prabhuji, can you please do the water service? Prabhuji, can you please serve, you know, clean the hall? Can you mop this? Can you do this service? Can you do that service? Can you do this service?" So then we get involved. Sometimes we think that I was treated royal in the first 3 days, and the fourth day onwards I am supposed to do something. But we won't hesitate to do that because we will enjoy doing this. The beauty of this process is the more and more we participate in this Krishna consciousness program, we start to enjoy that. And a very nice analogy that is given is of a pregnant lady. A pregnant lady, she has pain, she has nausea, she has so many symptoms. She has baby sometimes kicking in her, you know, in her stomach. And all of them, they don't give a very normal experience, it's a very pleasurable experience. So it is explained that Krishna consciousness program, even though apparently it's austerity, even though apparently it is with some layer of involvement and activities and servitor spirit, but it's so nice because we are going to reap a result. Like how a pregnant lady, if she does not get a kick, if she does not get a nausea, if she does not have any symptoms, she'll get frightened, "Oh my God, something is wrong." So every kick, every pain, every nausea, every trouble that she undergo, her pleasure increases. Because she is going to reach to the destination, and the more she goes closer to the delivery time, the more pain increases. But the result is so pleasing. So the journey of Krishna consciousness is very nicely explained that till Anartha Nivritti is one phase. Maybe it's the longest phase. But after Anartha Nivritti also, our actual Krishna consciousness journey, Rupa Goswami explains. So you start to partially experience Krishna's hand. Then you start experiencing almost completely. Then completely. Then thoroughly. Then absolutely thoroughly. So this is the fourth important point that I want to say, is that this Krishna consciousness program, that's the 123rd verse, apart from seeing you, whoever listens to your holy name is made mad with ecstatic love for Krishna and is able to deliver the three worlds. So if you see these points that have been explained from verse number 120 to 124, they are explaining about these aspects that I am talking about, how partially, almost completely, completely, thoroughly and absolutely thoroughly. So in our journey of Krishna consciousness, we need to know that we should somehow or other very soon come out of this problem situation, another negative situation. We should somehow work past, because there is some lot of more interesting things to do in Krishna consciousness. We just cannot go on fixing the nuts and bolts forever. We need to get into the actual groove. We need to get into the actual Krishna consciousness. Today what we are doing, chanting, hearing, reading, is nothing but actually preparation to be part of the spiritual journey. It's a preparation. It's fine, it is a means and the end, but at the same time, we need to actually get into the actual root. So Srila Prabhupada encourages that each and every devotee in this Krishna consciousness movement should take up Krishna consciousness so sincerely that they get qualified enough to actively take part in the Krishna consciousness project and eventually make it to the spiritual world. So we are not yet prepared to go to the spiritual world, but we should be conscious. So these all technicalities that Rupa Goswami explained is for us to kind of grade ourselves, for us to kind of position ourselves, for us to kind of set a goal to ourselves, where do we need to head up to. So like how we ended in Nishta in the last class, so now we need, after we see, get to the stage of Nishta, which means you partially realize Krishna behind every action, from that stage you need to start to get to the stage of absolutely thoroughly, which means there is no tinge of materialistic motive in our heart when we get to the stage of prema. And one last point, Rupa Goswami explains that till the stage of bhava, we need to be careful because we may tend to be carried away by materialistic propensities in some way or the other. And he gave an example of Jada Bharata. So Bharat Maharaj was in the stage of bhava when he got attracted to deer. So from Shraddha to bhava, there is a sincerely responsible journey that we need to, you know, carry ourselves forward, and we need to make that progress. That is why this is Krishna consciousness movement. There should be some movement. If there is standstill, then there is a problem. Anything that is standing still in one place, we have a problem. We have to move forward. We have to move closer. We have to definitely make progress in our Krishna consciousness journey, and that too year on year, month on month, day to day. We need to put some endeavor and make progress that are necessary to be done in our journey. So that's the fourth reflection that we bring into our table today. So these are the four reflections that are part of this 6-7 verses that we just read today. If there are any questions or comments, we can discuss. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Shri Chaitanya Charitamrita ki jai. Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bo. Any questions or comments?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam, All Guru Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev, Jai Jai Shri Radhe. Such a wonderful class, Prabhuji, touched to heart. Thank you very much for inspiring us and correcting us. Dandavat.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam. Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Actually, I was having 1-2 questions, but after hearing class, my questions become clear. So thank you so much, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada used to say that this Krishna consciousness movement is like a desire tree. And Srimad Bhagavatam is a desire tree. If you read Srimad Bhagavatam, all your questions, all your needs of spiritual life are fulfilled.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Very, very intense, very, very nice class. A lot to think about. I really like the analogy of the pregnant woman you gave and how you were talking about Anartha Navrati is actually the longest phase. I mean, it was there's a lot to think about in this class. Thank you so much for this very inspiring class, Prabhu. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Very nice class and very nice analogies also. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Today, tomorrow. So, wish you all a very happy Diwali.
Happy Diwali and then Govardhan Puja Day. Hare Krishna.
Govardhan Puja. We have Prabhupada Siruba. So, we have then so many festivals coming up.
Yes. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you all so much again. Wish you all a very happy Diwali and all the beautiful festivals that have been lined up. We can end the call now. वांछाकल्पतरूढश्च कृतासिन्धुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. अनन्तकोटिवैष्णवृन्द की जय. श्रीलप्रभुपाद की जय. रामगिरिधारी प्रभु की जय. हरे
कृष्ण. थैंक यू वेरी मच.
हरे कृष्ण.